Welcome along to the Granger Consortia Club. Just one other house thing to note that if anybody should be tweeting, and I hope you will be, Mike, we have a hashtag on the board there of LancashireGDC. So if you can put that on any message you send out from the room, or let's tell the world what we're doing. And I know at least half a dozen people here on Twitter, so everybody gets their phones up. So what are we going to do this morning? Very short presentations. We'll just leave some time from about 9:30 for networking and discussions. But effectively, we've gone through the introductions. We'll do a Green Deal refresher for those who are not necessarily up to speed with Green Deal as yet. We'll look at PALS 2030, which is key to Green Deals, you may well know. And then we'll look at the Green Deal Consortia Club, our intentions and aspirations, if you like, for how the Green Deal Club's going to come to be. And then we'll look at some of the nitty-gritty about fees and funding and all that stuff. Pass quickly on to what do we do next, when do we meet next, and what type of agenda we have into the future. I'd also like to give thanks to a number of organisations who have helped put this together. You can see them there, especially FNB, NFB, and to mention the UPlan. Just go back to that one. The Green Deals have attracted lots of attention. And I think we're particularly lucky here in Lancashire that we can launch something like this. All the other best practice clubs are watching us very closely. They want to do something very similar. We get a lot of interest from clients who want to be involved, and I'll talk as we go through. The numbers for this event have astounded us on the group putting this together. We started with a room for about 20 people. That soon became too small, so we went to a room for 40 people. We've gone up to 60 plus. I don't think everyone's here as yet, but to go from what we thought was 20 to 60, and we still have 25 people on a waiting list. So we need to work out how we're going to deal with those people, whether we just send them information or we hold another launch event very quickly. But a phenomenal interest in Green Deal. So as I say, we're actually quite lucky and privileged to be able to do something. Because Green Deal is going to start to change the way the industry works. Just a show of hands, how many people are aware of Green Deal and have gone along to other Green Deal events? So I know I'm talking to. Okay. So 50-50. Right. So just a couple of slides on Green Deal itself. Green Deal is this government's flagship as the greenest government ever to reduce CO2s. We have a UK obligation to reduce CO2, I think, by 80% by 2050. Okay. And this is all part of doing that. But it's also to address the existing building stock. The built environment, the way we build buildings, the way we design them, the way we use them, accounts for 40% of all carbons. We also generate 40% of all waste and all those sorts of things. So a huge contribution that we can make from the built environment to the national targets. And it's particularly important because, as it says here, 85% of today's buildings will still be standing, still be in use by the time we get to 2050. So we see the bulk of the construction, the bulk of the built environment sector really focusing on bringing the existing stock up to scratch. And if you follow market intelligence and market trends, that is where the bulk of construction spend is going to be. There are other reasons why Green Deal is so important. It's going to address fuel poverty and rising fuel costs. There's some astounding figures, such as for each 1% rise in fuel costs, another 40,000 households drop into fuel poverty. that's quite phenomenal. So the government are really pushing this to address these issues. Green Deal is effectively a loan system. It's a finance initiative. Effectively, as a homeowner or as a business owner, a building owner, you can borrow on a loan basis enough money to do your eco refits. And you pay that back as you pay back a mortgage over a period of time, 10, 15, 20, 25 years, depending on what you want to pay. There's this golden rule. Now, without going into too much details, the money you save on your energy bill, okay, plus the repayment for the loan you've taken out, has to be less than what you're paying today. Okay, so each household or each building premises will actually save money through the system. That's the intention. There's lots and lots of debate for how that's going to work through. The other key thing to bear in mind around Green Deal, it stays with the property. It's a charge on the property. So if you sell the factory, if you sell the house, you also sell your Green Deal finance arrangements. It's very much enshrined in law. It came into being in the Energy Bill late last year, October time of last year. We're expecting the second legislation in March of next month. I think lots of client organisations, local authorities and public sector are really waiting for that second legislation, because that will give the guidance as to what we're to do and the best way of running Green Deal. What is more or less a certainty though, Green Deal will commence in October this year. The government are putting too much great credence on this being that their flagship, not for it to happen. It could start as a big bang. It could be a small whimper and slowly grow. We wait to see. But we are already starting to see some of the intentions from the government. PAS 2030, which we'll talk about in a moment, is a standard which everyone working in Green Deal needs to comply with, has already been launched. So that's out there. That's been put out. The main consultation is in progress. The consultation period is closed, and DEC are now looking at all the consultations to develop that the mechanisms for the Green Deal. And so those mechanisms will come through in the second legislation next month. There are lots of standards and codes of practice being developed. PAS 2030, as I mentioned, is already issued. The code of practice is still in the draft form. Everybody, no matter what you do within Green Deal, will have to work to those two standards. But then you've got standards for microgeneration, you've got standards for an assessor, you've got standards for a provider. It's going to be very standard-driven, if you like. And one of the reasons that is to stop cowboys in the industry. You know, the people who burn up selling free solar power and all sorts of things. Which I think we're all subject to those calls. Interestingly, the main thrust at the moment is domestic. I think that's a political thing, because they want to bring housing stock up and fuel poverty. But Green Deal also applies to the commercial aspects. Okay. And I think that's going to be where the bulk of the value is. There'll be lots of work within the domestic sector. But as soon as we see developers, private landlords, etc., moving into Green Deal, refurbishing their own properties, that could be very big. On your table there's an extract from an article in Building Magazine just last week. A consortia of local authorities came together and said that their spend within Green Deal is going to be $1.75 billion. There's a few take away there, and that just starts to illustrate what the value and potential of Green Deal could be. I mentioned a couple of moments ago there's lots of uncertainties around Green Deal until we get that second legislation. But there are some very good certainties. And for us on the supply side of the industry, whether it be an installer of renewables, whether it be a general contractor doing loft insulation, etc., the certainties are very important. Because the certainties are, it will happen. It's the mechanisms and how will happen is the uncertainty. So it will happen this year. 2030, which we'll look at in a few moments, was issued earlier this month, so that's available. And it will change eco-refix and refurbishment, there's no doubt about that. We've now got a standard, like an ISO 9000 standard, for eco-refits. And you can see whoever's going to fund the money, whether it's through Green Deal, whether it's through private bank loans, etc., they're all indicating that they will need that standard as a safeguard so that they get a quality construction project or a quality refurbishment project. And you've probably seen in the press the debate which is growing over the last year or so about the industry, whether we have green skills or not, and what do we actually mean by green skills? If there ever was a certainty that, okay, well, let's look at what green skills we've got. What do we need? And the standards will start to illustrate, doing this particular trade, you need these qualifications. Not only in operative and delivery on site, but also right through the management structure. Yeah, so the green management, sustainable management, call it what you will. But we need the ability to make decisions from a sustainability point of view, whether we're doing QSing, whether we're doing buying, whether we're doing day-to-day management. So there's some certainties, those green skills right through the organisation. As to the uncertainties, well, how is all this funding going to work? The Green Deal Bank, the Green Bank is embryonic and just kicking off. We're starting to see big energy companies, the big six utilities, starting to put money into that. We're starting to see Marks and Spencers, maybe B&Q, etc., starting to invest. They've all got vested interest in doing so. But how is that actually going to flow down to the homeowner? Yeah, there's some very complex models being put together by DEC and VRE, etc. The certainty around funding, though, as I mentioned, the funding is to the property, not to the individual. Okay. And it's reclaimed by the energy company through your electricity meter or through the factory's electricity meter. And who does the assessing? That's the other big one. David might be able to talk about bit more about this at the moment, but there's a question whether the assessments up front to develop what measures, whether it's loft insulation, ground source heating, solar panels, etc. The person doing that, should that be for free? Or is there a cost on that? And who should be doing it? Should they be independent of the installers? Should they be independent of the funders? And I think we can all remember the fiasco around HIPS surveys a few years back. Yeah. So just trying to avoid that. I understand the assessor training is very comprehensive and could be a week or two in length for training those assessors, because they may also be offering a financial package like your mortgage advisor does. So coming to your property, to increase this SAP rating, we do X, Y, and Z. And here's the financial deal to go along with it. Yeah. So the role of the assessor is still there's consultation documents out, of course, and we should hear about that in the next few months. How it links to other existing programs is also an uncertainty. We all know about the CERTs and the SERPs and ECOs, etc. And we hear that they are diminishing and will cease when Green Deal comes in. So Green Deal could become the vehicle for all those existing improvement programs. The other thing to bear in mind with Green Deal, you could have a major refurb project which only pulls down, say, 10% of its value through Green Deal. The rest is funded, you know, by the client or whatever. Under all the legislation, or the Green Deal standard would apply to the whole project. So even if you put a penny of Green Deal funding into a project, you have to have the past 2030s, etc. So it's fundamentally changed the way we do things. And demand. The demand isn't quite there as yet. So the thrust is towards domestic and I hear from BRE they're planning adverts to appear between the middle of Coronation Street and EastEnders and all those. No, you don't get adverts between EastEnders, do you? But adverts between Coronation Street and EastEnders. Targeting homeowners. I mentioned the big utilities, Eons, British Gas, that they're gearing up to leaflet drops. And you can imagine the scenario where a British Gas leaflet comes through the door. Yeah, we can do the assessment, we can provide the money, we can do the building, we can do the installation, and we can put a solar panel on the roof. Sign up here, you can start tomorrow. And if ever there was a threat for construction, it's in that area. And we'll go on to look at the club in a moment. One of the reasons why we wanted to start the consortia is to safeguard work for Lancashire club members, effectively. So it doesn't go to the big six. Demand in the private sector is still unsure. Although, encouragingly, I was with a bunch of solicitors across in Leeds, and they said they are briefing big developers on Green Deal as the best way to attract money to bring their property up to standard. What will be a big trigger and initiative for the private sector is that I think it's from 2014, so check these figures, but from 2014, you will not be able to let, sell, resell, relet a property which has an EPC rating of below D.
2016,
is it? Yeah, so after 2016, you come up with. So that's going to be a big trigger for private landlords to bring all their stock up to at least a D rating. The other thing which could help a lot on demand is the role of the local authorities, particularly the planning departments. Part of the consultation is that the local authority should be a trigger to every time anyone makes an application, build an extension, refurb a factory. The planning authority should be saying, well, whilst you're doing that, you should be bringing the rest of the building up to X standard. Now, how far they can enforce that is out for consultation at the moment, and will be part of that secondary legislation. All this is being driven through the government by Greg Barker, who, when he launched the consultation, said 35 minutes ago, but it was back in November, put this statement out via Twitter. Another big step forward in the biggest home improvement programme since World War II. And once you start to look at Green Deal and the mechanics and the potential, he's not too far wrong there.